environmental as being a significant data science category. It alluded to the fact there wasn't as much money there to be made, though. I was like, this could be a turnoff for people, but you know. So let me tell you a little bit about what I've been doing. For over 20 years, I've actually been working with this utility, among other water supply utilities. I specialize, I'm an environmental scientist, and after getting my master's degree, studying an endangered species, well, not technically endangered, but you know, it's a Florida mouse that lives in gopher tortoise burrows. And turned out that mostly when I got out of graduate school, I realized people were only interested in wetlands. So from an environmental protection standpoint, you know, wetlands is really where a lot of work is done. So I started to focus on wetlands and work with Tampa Bay Water, one of my longest standing clients. They're the largest wholesale drinking water supplier in Florida. They supply water for over 2.3 million people in the Tampa Bay area. And so these gray shapes on here, these represent groundwater supply wellfields. And there's 11 of them in the central system area. Some of these are really old, like going back to the 40s. And so Tampa Bay Water produces the water and then sells it to the member governments. That's the wholesale part, and then they sell it to their customers. Now, up until about 2003, nearly all of the water was coming out of the ground to provide for this area. But in 2003, they started to withdraw high water flows from the Alafaya River, and they built a reservoir, and they actually have a diverse portfolio now of where they're getting their water from. They also have seawater desalination, so they're not just relying on that. So I'm not sure if I'm advancing this.
Was there a business need for this to do it?
You're getting ahead of me. No.
Actually, if you prefer questions afterwards.
No. It's fine. You can pipe up for sure. Yes. So actually, this was really driven by the recognition of environmental impacts that were occurring. One of the projects I worked on, I actually mapped over 2,000 acres of fallen trees in the floodplains in the Tampa Bay area. So it was me and other scientists recognizing these impacts were occurring. So this led them to recognize that they couldn't just withdraw water. It rains a lot. You think, hey, it rains 55 inches a year. How come there's not enough water? But actually, we can suck more than that out of the ground. And so during drier times, during drier years, we could have environmental impacts. So in fact, let's talk about that. What lies beneath? What lies beneath us, beneath this building we walk around on? It's very similar to what you have in the Tampa Bay area. You have a surficial aquifer system, which is mostly sand. If you start digging a hole in the backyard, you know, that's what you're in. You're in the surficial aquifer. Mm-hmm. Now, beneath that some distance, there could be a confining layer, or sometimes that's actually an aquifer that can produce water. And oftentimes it's just a thick clay, and that's called the confining layer, and that separates the surficial aquifer from the Floridan aquifer, which is a limestone. And that's where the caves are. If you ever go to Okiwa or something like that, you see the springs. So those caves are actually in the aquifer. If you go down in there, you're in the drinking water aquifer at that point. Now, the interesting thing is, we see that there's variable confinement between the surficial aquifer and the Floridan aquifer. So this clay layer is not nice and continuous like it shows there. And so you have areas where there's little clays or where there's sinkholes through the clays, things like that. And so the result is that sometimes when you're pumping water, it can induce recharge and draw additional water down from the Floridan, from the upper, from the surficial. And this happens naturally. This is really what aquifer recharge is. And this is what the high areas around here actually are recharging water in other parts of the state. And some of our water is recharged even from Georgia. So, and contaminants go the other direction. When things get spilled on the ground, they can end up down in the aquifer by this path. Now what we see is that because of areas of concentrated production that occurred, especially in the past, you have something like a cypress wetland on the left side there, which we call a no-change or no-stress cypress wetland. The trees are all there. You see some nice clear water marks on the trees. To something like on the right, which is, yeah, this presentation's definitely got a mind of its own. Maybe you know how to stop that from advancing? Just trying to make sure I get done on time. Yeah, it's on some kind of auto where it's advancing. No? Just bumping things? I'll try not bumping anything for a few minutes and see what happens. Okay, so the wetland on the right actually looked like the wetland on the left, okay? Prior to the soils drying out, in the wetland, normally the water table is close to the land surface. So even if there's not water above ground, it can still, it's definitely on its own. Yeah. So even if there's not water level above ground, that water actually maintains the structure of the soil because these soils develop in anaerobic conditions without oxygen. So when you expose them to oxygen, the soils can decompose. I've seen over a foot of soils disappear in 1 year. And when that happens, the trees will fall down, you'll get weedy species invading, you'll get a big change in the structure of the wetland. And of course, there's all different grades in between, and there's also different types of wetlands, but I'm just giving you an idea that it does lead to changes. So I want to introduce you to the historical normal pool. I can walk into a wetland, especially a cypress wetland, and tell you a lot about the hydrology of what's been happening last year, 3 years ago, and even 10 years ago, just by looking at the marks on the trees. So for example, where this tree is swollen, this is a result of this cypress tree growing up under a certain hydrologic regime. And that bump on the tree, we call it the cypress buttress inflection point, that reflects an area that's associated with a particular water level, approximately the 3% exceedance level. So meaning the water only gets above that elevation 3% of the time. It's very regular in some systems, and it matches very closely with the water level information. So this gives us an idea of where the water used to get in the system. Also, the water is keeping the moss collars from growing there. And one of the things that, because of the regularity of this, we've been able to develop approaches to understand how current water levels are relative to historical water levels and what's healthy for that system. Also, we can use this elevation to remove the artifact, this elevation in each wetland to remove the artifact of elevation itself. So this is a map that I did quite a few years ago, and there's actually 270 different monitored wetlands in there. It's the median water level for a 6 year period, water year 97 to 2002. A water year is like a regular year except it starts in October. And so for that period, mapped the median water levels, but first subtracted the local datum, that historic normal pool. So this puts all the wetlands on a common scale, and you actually begin to get some information out of a map. And so what we see is that in certain areas, like on the wellfields, these red colors represent more than 7 feet of water level below the median water level below the historic normal pool. So in the areas of concentrated withdrawals, and also there was a drought time included in this, you've got some areas where the water levels are much lower. Okay, so it gives you a nice picture there. Okay, so because of these environmental impacts that were observed, Tampa Bay Water worked with the Southwest Florida Water Management District, and they agreed to cut back their pumpage and shift to other sources. So there was a big cutback that happened in 2003, where they went from an average of 158 million gallons a day down to 120, and then since then it's even gone down to 90, and they've kept it below 90 since 2008. So we have a wonderful opportunity to study the ecological recovery, so a big ecological experiment. And how do we know whether the affected lakes and wetlands have recovered? Well, we do have some guidance. This was a document that was developed in 1999, and really studied these relationships to come up with the idea that if the median water level is within 1.8 feet of the historic normal pool, that's probably going to be a wetland that's okay in terms of its condition. So it gives us an idea of a general threshold that you can use. And we know that applies to cypress wetlands and cypress-fringed lakes. But their vegetative and hydric soils improvements are likely to take time, so it could be a lag time in recovery. So here's an example of following a wetland over time. This is what we call a hydrograph. Essentially, the blue line is a plot of the water levels over time. And there's some levels on here. The green represents that historical normal pool I was talking about in the cypress tree. The brown is the bottom of the wetland, meaning the dry part in the center. And then this yellow line represents the normal pool offset, or this what we call the surrogate minimum level. If you follow a 6 year median water level over time, it's only after the cutbacks in a couple of years that it pops above that minimum level. So now this wetland is one that we consider had stress before hydrologically. You can see the water levels are mostly below ground, and then now it's recovered hydrologically. Yes, question?
I'm just trying to keep my brain up.
Sure.
Context. This is measured in a certain region around Tampa?
Yes, this is one particular site. So if we go back to this map, okay, each of these green dots is a wetland. So there's 270 that are shown on this map. This is old Tampa Bay right here. So this is kind of like the West Coast. They're spread out over this whole, this three-county area, Pasco, Hillsborough, Pinellas. And these are the, these shapes represent the well fields. So those are generally the areas where there's concentrated groundwater withdrawals. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay. So this is one particular wetland that was recognized as being stressed ecologically and hydrologically because the six-year median water level was well below what we consider to be kind of a safe level for that type of well. And in particular, this is what we call a mesic cypress site. So the district initially didn't acknowledge that there were differences among the types, but we recognize that, that there's more than one type of, even among the cypress domes. Some have these sandy soils, and sandy soils surrounding them, and sand pine scrub surrounding them. These are what we call xeric-associated wetlands. These are mesic-associated wetlands. These are more set in a pine flatwood setting, where the you often have water levels above ground for brief periods during the rainy season. So, you know, it's interesting. Some parts of Florida are actually wet with above ground water for maybe a week or two out of the year, and yet they're not considered wetlands. So it's kind of interesting. I mean, essentially the definition of wetland is a legal definition. I mean, it's actually wet. It's just not wet long enough to meet that legal definition. Okay, and so when we look at this from a digital elevation model perspective, this is DEMs that were made with LiDAR data. And so this is a lake here and a nearby wetland that's kind of right next to it. And you can see how deep it is. These have the same amount of vertical exaggeration. So here, this cypress dome, it's actually a cypress marsh, S8. These wetlands tend to be isolated and they occur as deep internally drained sinkholes. So these are really internally drained. When you look at the mesic-associated wetlands, they tend to be shallower and they tend to be connected during the rainy season. So they start to connect together in the landscape. So really a different landscape position. And then this one eventually drains to the river. So they tend to be shallower. So you'd expect they have different levels that are appropriate. And here we can see a similar view where we've classified the soils based on the vegetation type in the soils maps into orange meaning xeric and green meaning mesic. And if we kind of trace down here, you can see a lot of these xeric areas are associated with the ridges in the landscape. A lot of these ridges are very subtle. Floor is very flat, but there is a little bit of a topographic change there. Okay, so we recognize these xeric soils and xeric set wetlands have, they're deeper, they have more fluctuations. So we recognize they really have a different water level, a different surrogate minimum level that separates the stressed and the non-stressed sites. And in a previous study, we came up with minus 3.1. This level is actually changing again, but that's where it was at the time. So here's an example of a hydrologic recovery of what we would consider a xeric soil type. And now here's that normal pool again, but now we allow a lower median water level to still be considered recovered because this wetland has more fluctuation. And so again, after the cutbacks, we see a recovery where the median came above the water level. Okay. That covers monitored wetlands, so there's some 300 of those. What about all the unmonitored wetlands that are in areas that have drawdown? So in this case, we're specifically concerned about areas that have at least 2 feet of superficial aquifer system drawdown. This is predicted from integrated hydrologic models. So what about these sites that are shown in green? There's 675 wetlands and 9 lakes. We don't know anything about them. We need to know how are they doing. So this is where the statistics comes in. I know you're waiting for that, right? So, and this led to this problem, which is, how do we come up with this? And I opted for some type of interpolation. So using nearby sites to estimate conditions at the unmonitored sites. And then the question becomes, well, nearby in what sense? Is it a statistical sense, like nearest neighbors? Some of you may have used that algorithm. Or is it a spatial sense, something like a geostatistical sense? So I say, why do I have to choose? There's only a couple people old enough to remember this commercial. So I'll tell you, it's a commercial from like the late 70s. The young man was walking with his chocolate bar in the morning. The lady was walking with her peanut butter. I've never actually seen that happen. And they bumped into each other. So I'm sure it was kind of like a match made in heaven. But it ended up, right? They didn't have to choose. They found out that initially they were mad, but they got over it because they realized that chocolate and peanut butter actually go together. Okay. All right. So, but before I jump into regression kriging, I want to talk just a quick review of linear regression. And this is actually a 200-year-old data mining technique. I think this is probably the oldest data mining technique. And the method of least squares. We have in a simple linear regression, we're predicting a y variable using an x variable. That's our explanatory variable, or you also hear me call them auxiliary variables in this geostatistical context. And essentially, we're fitting the line of best fit, which minimizes the squared residuals around the line. So there's, as you know, there's only one line that does that. It's pretty cool. And it's hopefully an unbiased line in that context. But you do end up with these residuals. You have positive residuals and you have negative residuals that aren't actually predicted well by this particular model. Maybe you're missing a variable that you need to add to better predict those. Or maybe you don't know why, but when you map these residuals, you find that they are spatially autocorrelated. You have a bunch of wetlands that are still unusually low in this particular area, even though you've already included all of your variables. That's an example of where you actually have spatial autocorrelation in your residuals. You can model that spatial autocorrelation, and then you can add that to your predictive model. Okay, so the assumptions of linear regression, linearity and additivity of the relationship between x and y. You also assume independence of the error term, homoscedasticity, which is constant error variance, and then normality of errors. Okay, how about a 70-year-old data mining technique brought to you by Danny Krieg, who is a mining engineer who worked in South Africa and helped develop or adapt a technique that would help them to figure out where was the gold hiding. And so the basis for this is really a very sophisticated spatial interpolation technique. And when I say very sophisticated, that means I can't keep up with all of the linear algebra. But someone who wants to study this in detail, I think you'd really enjoy it. It accounts for spatial covariance amongst all the data points, and then also spatial covariance between all the data points and the point to be estimated. So the result is that it avoids, for example, overweighting points that are right near each other, like maybe some other techniques might do, like some of the simpler inverse distance weighted and things like this. Now, in order to do this, you actually have to model the spatial covariance, and how you do that is with something called a variogram. So if you do any geostatistics, you'll need to do variograms or let autofit variogram do it for you, which is what I did for this project. And but this is a variogram, and what these dots represent is they represent the variance among points that are at a similar lag distance from each other. So if you've got so what you see is that points that are near each other in space, like maybe five units apart, are much more similar. They have smaller variance in the differences than the points that are this far away. And eventually you reach a point where there appears to be a constant. There's no longer a significant spatial autocorrelation past that point. And that's something that you want to be aware of. So this is a model that needs to be fit. After fitting this model, you can then do the Kriging. Okay, so the assumptions of ordinary Kriging, there's many flavors of Kriging, and I'm not gonna go into all of them. But in this particular method, you want stationarity, meaning a constant but unknown mean and variance across the study area. Also, you want isotropy. In other words, the variogram structure is the same in all directions. So in practice, this may not be true, but it could be still useful for estimation. And that brings me to my point. You hear me talking about assumptions? I'm not usually really that hung up on assumptions. And probably a lot of you are not either. And this really gets at the idea of what are we using the multivariate statistical analysis for in the first place. So I think this paper is worth reading if you haven't looked at that. She talks about the idea that statistical model building can be used for identifying important factors, you know, worthy of further experimental study, but really there's ultimately no way to get around multicollinearity unless you really understand the system. And so that's something to be aware of. And along those same lines, prediction, really, you don't need to have any concern about multicollinearity. In some cases, your algorithm might be able to handle it. In other cases, it could be a problem for your algorithm. But it all depends on whether you're really trying to understand the factors or whether you're just trying to predict. Must I choose? I try to do both. So you'll see I try to do both. So this is my conceptual diagram for regression kriging. We first identify the most likely multiple linear regression model while avoiding overfitting. Then we perform kriging on the residuals from that model, and then we add them together to generate the best model that includes both spatial, espatial and spatial aspects of the prediction. So in some ways I think of it as you do your modeling and then you're kind of shrink wrapping to your actual data at the end. And you're assuming that shrink wrapping is going to pull appropriately other points near those points also into alignment to improve the predictability. Okay, so introducing you to the data, 309 sites we had water level data for this period 2008 to 2014, calculated the medians, subtracted the normal pools. So they're all negative values, or a couple were just slightly above zero. I made them zero. So let's zoom in a little bit, and you can see, here's an example of really a large abrupt change where this wetland, the median water level is only about 2.5 feet below the normal pool. You get onto the well field here, and now you have 17 feet below normal. So really a big change. Any interpolation method is gonna have challenges, you know, with the uncertainty there. Here's another example where I noticed there was a big abrupt change. Okay, I did go ahead and transform the dependent variable to help achieve normality. And so this is the starting variable. You can see it ranges from like 0 to minus 20 almost. And then this is after transformation. This is like a transformation that I made up. So now that I've done more work with R and more work with machine learning, I would probably just do Box-Cox trans. I don't know if you guys have used that, but very handy to come up with the Box-Cox transformation. So I would recommend that. But in this case, this seems to work for this problem. Okay, so what is machine learning? I'm preaching to the choir here, right? this is a slide I like to use to kind of introduce other people that I talk with, you know, environmental scientists that aren't into it as we are. But and there's another subtle joke here for those of you who are around my age, a little older. You know, field of computer science obviously develops algorithms and then also applying those algorithms. Generally, focus more on prediction than explanation, and of course, it's widespread, especially in the age of the internet, with things like product recommendations, and price estimation, advertising, all that good stuff. This is actually, I copied that off of Kaggle, for those of you, I'm sure a lot of you know about the Kaggle contest, and that was one of the things that really got me excited about machine learning when I started playing around. With Excel, but this was a contest to do image segmentation and identification of whales, which is great to help the researchers, hopefully the whales. Many different choices of algorithms to use in machine learning, so I know you're probably familiar with many beyond this list, so I'm not going to go over the whole thing, but I will talk just a little bit. I talked a little bit about regression, I'll talk a little bit about decision tree and random forest and ensemble technique. So this, again, is one, maybe not exactly the slide, but this concept I like to always share with people when I talk to them about machine learning, because I think it's such a beautiful and fundamental concept, which is, you know, the idea that you have this set of points, and here's two possible ways of developing a model to predict, right, the future points, the underlying relationship. And one of the nice things about this line is that it exactly predicts all of these points. Pretty good, right? But you know, how well is it going to do when I give someone a minus 4.2, you know, something like this? Are they going to predict this as the point, or are they going to be better off predicting this? So it's the idea of overfitting is really our parsimony. And this is a figure to support that, just noting that this is the error variance. And as we train models extensively, or we make them more complex, include more terms, ultimately we're going to keep improving our performance on the training set, but there will reach a point where you're no longer training signal, you're training noise. And when that happens, then your test error on future data is going to go up. You got to find that sweet spot. So you can do that with your algorithm, cross-validation, something like that. All right, so this brings me to what I call like my machine learning paradigm and approach. Normally, most of these algorithms, you've got to fill data or get rid of cases that don't have data. I like to use a training and a testing set in many cases. Train the model using the training data and avoid overfitting. Tune the model if there's hyperparameters. And then evaluate the tuned model and test data set. Refit the model for predictions using the same hyperparameter settings, but for the whole data set, because usually that will improve your performance. And then finally, look at the residuals. See if there's spatial correlation. And if there is, create the residuals. So this is these are the variables I was working with, some aquifer-related variables, some soils-related variables, well-related variables, and some miscellaneous ones, like the size of the wetland. I'm gonna through some pictures of these. But I what I did was a Bayesian information criterion search for the best model out of 2048 using the R package GL multi. So it's essentially kind of a wrapper for the best subsets or reg subsets, I think. Goes through all the regressions and uses this penalized likelihood method. So finding the most likely model to explain the data with a penalty for additional variables to avoid overfitting. That's the text there for. So it turned out with this 11 variables, there was actually 2,048 different possible models. So one, for example, might only have Zurich ratio in it, one model. Another model is gonna have all 11 of these variables in it. So you can see that this is essentially model selection kind of comes down to variable selection when I do this. So here's one of the variables that we looked at. It's surficial aquifer system drawdown. And so this is essentially output from an integrated hydrologic model that looks at changes in water levels in cells with pumping. And so these different colors represent the intensity of drawdown that's occurring at these locations. And for example, the red areas have like about 9 feet of drawdown in the center of the wellfields. And this is an average condition. And when we look at the drawdown relative, the superficial drawdown relative to the normal pool offset, and remember this is transformed, so it really kind of goes in the other direction. But there is a relationship here that in the areas of higher drawdown, you generally have larger normal pool offsets, lower water levels. Okay, we talked about the soil differences, that there's xeric soils and mesic soils, and we've created maps like this using vegetation of which soils are xeric and mesic, and then perform buffering operations in GIS, where we add up the amount of area of xeric and mesic soils and calculate a xeric soil ratio. And then that can be used to divide the wetlands into ones that are xeric and mesic. When we try to divide them in a binary way like that, I usually use 27% as a cutoff. 27 and greater is considered xeric. And what happens when we subdivide now? We looked before at the superficial aquifer relationship and the normal pool offset. When we subdivide by is it high xeric or low xeric soils, we see the possibility of an interaction here, that the more xeric sites, they may have lower water levels at a lower level of superficial drawdown. So this is important if you're trying to understand the systems and how they may be operating. Also, normal pool offset is directly related to xeric ratio, and the water levels are lower in the sites with the higher xeric ratio. Distance to nearest well, I think that one's self-explanatory. And it does seem to have a relationship there with the sites farther from the wells have higher water levels, the line goes down. Head difference. Head difference is the difference in the pressure the water will rise to in an open borehole. And so that difference between the superficial aquifer and the Florida aquifer. This is from a statewide layer. And so it's questionable how accurate it's going to be, if it's going to be of the spatial scale that we need, but I did include it in the model. Soil permeability is another layer that was available from the Florida Aquifer Vulnerability Assessment. You just kind of get an idea of the distribution of that. Some soils are very leaky and the water will percolate right away. Other soils, they'll hold the water, like a pond in those locations. You know, these areas have very low permeability because they're actually filled with organic soils. They're floodplains. Intermediate aquifer. I mentioned the intermediate aquifer, in some places it's thick, well confined, in other areas it's wide open. So according to the statewide level resolution, Tampa Bay area is wide open. It's not exactly true. There are areas of confinement, but it's definitely variably confined. Rainfall. I took 12 stations, or 11 stations I could readily get data for, and then calculated average water level for this 7-year period and did a nearest neighbor interpolation with 10 nearest neighbors. And essentially this area was dry during this time period. So there's also differences there. Kernel density, this is another way of looking at what the wells are doing. So in some areas the wells are very dense. It's a little misleading because this wellfield, Eldridge Well, is very old, and at that time the wells were much smaller and they occurred at a much higher density. Many of them are not in operation. So now we get to the results, all right? These are the results, and this is a lot of fun if you guys have ever used this package, GL Multi. This is actually animated. It uses Java. You'll see it running through. through each of the models and calculating the VIC, and you know, you're kind of like just waiting for it to really drop, and eventually it does, and you get your best model. So the lowest VIC is your best model. Now what you want to pay attention to though is this red line. This is two VIC units, and one of the rules of thumb, of course, is that if you have multiple models in this area, you may want to consider model averaging as the best solution, if you've looked into this at all. But in this case, we had one. It was the normal pool offset was a function of an intercept and surficial drawdown and xeric ratio. So only one was within that. Here's some other output we get from the BIC best model. So this is the BIC best model. Its model weight is 41%. Meaning there's a 41% probability it's the best one of the 2048 evaluated. So it's kind of cool. I feel like the party's already started. So where's my beer? here's another nice output we get from this GL multi. We can calculate model averaged importance of the terms, and this is based on the sum of weights of all the models that include that variable. So it gives you some idea of importance of the variables, and the SAS drawdown and the xeric ratio came out way ahead of everything else. This also outputs for the top five models, which these aren't very interesting to us, a plot of the residuals versus the fitted, so we can look at homogeneity of variance of the residuals, and also a normal QQ plot, so you can look at normality, which we have some departures from normality, but okay, so what's our performance or our summary here of this particular model? It's actually, with the training data only, it's actually pretty low. Let's say the R squared is about 25%. Now, instead of looking at these coefficients and going, I think drawdown does that, I like to use the VisRig package. It's a nice way to visualize the partial residuals from the model. Yes, question?
Before you go to the residuals, when you showed the variograph, how does the, you know, having this, the mesic and the, what's the other one?
The xeric
soil side by side, and having such difference in the you know, what do you call it, the drawdown? Or the gap between the normal pooling level and the actual level? Like, how do you, your barograms probably won't look as good as the picture you showed, right? And what did you do to kind of split that, or?
Well, with the variogram, you know, essentially, we're hopefully going to take care of that. If xeric is a factor in the model when we do linear regression, then that will be adjusted at that point. So then, when we're looking at residual variation, hopefully the xeric and the mesic would have similar residual variation. So it's an assumption. You know, it's essentially an assumption. I am going to show you ordinary Kriging result though, which does fall into the what you're noting there, that they might have different characteristic spatial variation. So yes, that's a good point. So that would be something that would go against the idea that ordinary Kriging would be appropriate here. Since we know this about xeric and mesic ahead of time, it probably makes sense to subset our data. But then at the same time, you might lose sample size, you know, so you might lose power to understand what's happening with the system. So I feel like that's a trade-off that you have to kind of decide after.
But do you get a clear distance cutoff about what stations are correlated? Yes.
I'm going to show you yes and no. I'm going to show you the variogram coming up here. Okay, so maybe we can talk about it again when we get to that slide.
Okay.
But if the variogram never achieves that flattening out, then that may mean that you have a regional trend that you need to account for. So you may have to detrend your data for something, which is essentially what we're doing with the regression curve. We're removing a trend associated with the variables that we think are important for predicting the wetland water levels, and then we're just modeling the residual spatial autocorrelation. Okay. So VisRig is kind of a neat package, and there may be some other packages that do this, but I mean, I'd much rather look at these pictures than look at regression coefficients. So this gives us an idea in a multivariate regression, when you hold the other variables constant at their median, what pattern do you have in terms of the relationship with the variable. So here we can see, this is very much like the exploratory plots that I showed before. It appears that the water levels are lower when we have higher surficial drawdown, and here the water levels are also lower. It's going up because of that's lower here because with xeric ratio. So not a surprise. Okay, how do we then evaluate it on the test set? So this is what I like to do. I like to look at the root mean squared error. I also like to look at R squared, and I like to look at a plot of the predicted and the observed data. So interestingly here, so here's the output, and I actually just recently discovered this in Caret, this default summary. It's a nice little script that's part of Caret that allows you, if you format your data right, to generate the root mean squared error, the R squared, and the mean absolute error. What you can see is we jumped up from 25% to now on the test set we're at 39% R squared. So that's nice. Okay, must be a non-representative test set, right? That happens when you randomly select your test set. But the root mean squared error went in the wrong direction. It actually got worse. Okay, so here. Okay, now what about plotting this observed and predicted? Who here thinks we should do predicted versus observed, which is the plot on the top? I see a show of hands on predicted versus observed. Nobody? Okay, who thinks we should do the one on the bottom, observed versus predicted? There's not a single voter in here. Do I have to hand out buttons to you guys? Maybe if you voted on your phone, it'd be anonymous. Okay, it's okay. Who doesn't know the answer? That still leaves a lot of you guys that think you know the answer, but you're not willing to commit.
Well, obviously you should do predicted versus predicted. And I need to clarify what I'm suggesting here. But basically, when you have this kind of models, in order to validate what you're doing, you try to see is this model holding in some similar environment, say in Africa or whatever, in Europe. Ideally, because the problem with this approach is that you still might have overtrained. From these 2,000 models, you have chosen the most trained one. You understand what I'm saying? You're overtraining in a different way, not for the parameters, but for the selection of models. So the question is...
Well, hopefully not. So that's the point of the BIC, and I might have glazed over that a little bit, because I know BIC's been out there for a long time. You know, I think AIC was the first one, and so the whole point of that of a penalized likelihood method is that, you know, you're calculating the most likely model given this particular data, but you're penalizing it for the number of variables that you're including, and so in a sense, ideally it shouldn't be overtrained because of the BIC. The BIC,
I'm not saying the model is overtrained. I'm saying your selection, in some sense, throwing 2,000 models, mm-hmm. you know, in some sense, overtraining. Or to clarify this, I think this is slide 35 or whatever, in which the when you show the red line with the threshold of the models going down, which was selected the best, the actual range was not that high. I mean, maybe I don't see that well, but it's like, say, between 290 and 302 uh-huh. or something like that. Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, any kind of graph, any kind of flat line, I can mm-hmm. sort them and compress it, and then I'm going to select an outlier or maximum one. But this doesn't mean that it's the best one. Okay. So in some sense, there's some overtraining from a meta perspective, from methodological perspective. And the question is, to what degree this model is going to hold in a different situation? Is it instead of like say withholding the data, as withholding some of the data and making the tests? Is it possible this model to work in a different environment? Like I do this in healthcare. Like models in one particular hospital, they work well, but if you move it to another hospital, it doesn't. So from 12 models, I actually select the one which actually transfers, you know, works in all of them. Yes,
you know
what?
That makes sense.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm talking about when I said predicted versus predicted, this is what I meant. It's like right now, I don't know. Like it's a philosophical question. Do you have enough data to actually make statistical conclusions?
Yeah.
And this is another thing which I didn't see that one.
It's a good question. Yeah. And I think that so just to be clear, because I think some of you might not know this or realize this, but in this case, the observed, you know, their actual data that the model has never seen.
Right.
That's my 20% test set. Okay.
Yeah.
So the model hasn't seen those. And then the question is, I'm asking you all, what do you think is the appropriate way to evaluate them, comparing my model predictions using the training data to the actual, you know, test data? I'm asking for a vote. just go and say that you're not sure.
Yeah. I'll just.
Is either one okay?
Sure. I mean, of course, you wanna see how they compare. It's like, what is the comparisons like? Do you do ordinary statistics? You know, order statistics. Do you do like a Riemann square?
So that's. No, but that's what I'm saying I do when I look at test data. I'm looking at the root mean square, which is a measure of the average error. I'm looking at the R square between, you know, the observed and expected or observed and predicted. And then I'm also looking at a plot of predicted and observed, but specifically I'm looking at a plot of observed versus predicted. So you want your observed on the y-axis and your predicted on the x-axis. So I think of it as like O over P in the alphabet if you're reading down the page to try to remember. Interestingly, half of publications get it wrong, which I think is amazing, right? I mean, this is why we need data science, why we need a community, why we need people to do research and get their information out there. I mean, half the people are doing it wrong, you know? So, anyway, there it is.
Can you elaborate why it's wrong?
Why it's wrong?
Yeah.
Okay, now you're gonna make me work.
No, I just think, like, I mean, if you, as long as you're
It doesn't seem like it should be wrong,
right?
Well, it turns out that when you calculate the R squared, it's okay either direction. R squared comes out to be the same answer. But a regression is not the same if you flip the Y and the X, because a regression only minimizes the sum of squares in one dimension. So regression, the normal, you know, model one regression that we do all the time, it only minimizes the sums of squares in Y, not X. And that's the reason why they don't give you the same answer. That's the reason why the one-to-one line. So what we want to see in a well-behaved model to see if your model is doing well on new data is you want to see that the one-to-one line, which is shown here in red, is going to be a similar slope to your actual line of best fit between the observed and predicted. Okay? If these are similar, and these are close. There's a little bit of a twist here. It's not perfect, but it is kind of a small sample size, so I'm not hung up on it. But if you see something like this and you actually plotted it correctly, you would be pretty sure your model was misspecified in some way. So this gives you an idea if your one-to-one line fits with observed versus predicted, then you think, hey, my model's pretty good, properly specified. Everybody okay?
Don't use regression. I mean, this is something I've been talking to the previous folks.
Okay. All right, this is a two-beer discussion. Two-beer discussion. All right, so anyway, so I just thought that was neat. I mean, I found that I wanted to share it, and so hopefully it'll also work. Okay, so now let's use all the data, though, and instead of worrying about a test set, go ahead and do tenfold cross-validation using Carrot. So I'm sure a lot of you who use R have probably discovered Carrot and how wonderful it is. And so this is kind of the code set up there. I am putting all this on the GitHub site too. And anyway, so what do we end up with? This is the cross-validated root mean squared error in the R-squared. So now these are basically between the test set and the training set. So this is more likely represents performance on future data for this model. Still kind of below R-squared, right? Okay, now one of the things that we talked about earlier was we talked about these two variables as being the most likely to be included as the correct variables to use in the model, but I mentioned there may be an interaction. I didn't search for interaction terms. You can actually set the level equals to a GL multi, and it will search all possible interactions. Now you're getting up to a tremendous number of models, well over a billion models. So in order to do that, you have to implement the genetic algorithm aspect of it, which I've done before. It works very well. It also takes a long time to run. But depending on what your settings are, you can look at interactions. And then you're definitely going to be getting it overfitting. Because I did play around with that, and you know, you can definitely get into some overfitting when you're looking at a billion models. Okay. So what I said was, well, let's go ahead and allow this interaction because I think this is real. So you can define the interaction with an asterisk instead of a plus sign. So essentially you have three terms, and now the R squared bumped up a little bit. So I went from 28 to 32, and there was a slight improvement also in the root mean squared error. So I said, I'm gonna go with that. That's gonna be my best linear regression model. And here's a VisRec plot now showing the interaction. So this shows is that these are xeric ratio sites with between 0 and 80% xeric, and these are the high xeric ratio sites, greater than 80%. Here's the relationship between the water levels and the drawdown. And what you can see is there is a slope difference. So the xeric sites seem to have more drawdown at the same amount of production. Okay. Let's drop now worrying about auxiliary variables. Let's back up and say, what can geostatistics do with this data set? Let's completely ignore variables. Let's just model the water levels. Let's model the transformed water levels using ordinary Kriging. And we can do that using the R package auto map. And so here is that here's that variogram that we were talking about, what it's going to look like when we don't have any variables. And this is how you get this to run. And so you can see there's the variogram, and fit the variogram. It kind of looks like it doesn't really level off though. So there could be some trend in the study area. So maybe if I was to really do this from a geostatistical standpoint properly, probably want to try to make sure that I've captured any, removed any trend that's there. And this is the nice output that we get when we provide a grid to AutoMap. You can go ahead and fill in your whole study area here. Unfortunately, it gives you a very small picture. But this is the Kriging prediction. Kriging also gives you a standard error, so a spatially explicit estimate of the error at that location. So that can be useful for some applications. How good is it though? Well, AutoMap conveniently provides a leave one out cross validation routine, so I don't have to write something or use caret or anything. I just use this command autokrieg.cv and go ahead and run it again. And what I found is that the prediction is strong for this problem. And the R squared was actually 36% now, and the root mean squared error was down to 41. And I think our observed versus predicted plot is well behaved there. So Kriging is good. Kriging is better. Okay. So how about combining chocolate and peanut butter? Now, one thing you'll note here is that this is really now a residual variogram. So this is after we've modeled linear regression, extracted the residuals, and we're doing Kriging on the residuals. So the variance isn't as high. There's not as much variance to explain because it's already been explained by the regression. In some cases, in more recent projects, I've done this with random forests with 29 variables, and I've actually explained so much variation, there's nothing left to explain with the Kriging. So the spatial is gone. But in this case, with these 11 variables, we weren't getting to that point. There was still some spatial autocorrelation that was observable in nearby sites. So there's our variogram model. And here's the results. Again, we get a Kriging prediction and a standard error for that. How well did it do? Again, we can use cross-validation and AutoMap to get at that idea. Ooh, now we're up to 41% R squared. I like this direction we're going in. Root mean squared error is down to 40. So this is our regression Kriging model. It is better than either the Kriging or the regression model, which is really good because I was not going to show up today if it came out different. Okay, so regression Kriging does not have to use regression. That's one of my colleagues that'll do anything to get a good photo. So if you like nature photos, check out his website and the video. But regression Kriging doesn't have to use regression. You can substitute your favorite machine learning algorithm. Run the algorithm, look at the residuals, map them, if they're spatial autocorrelation, do your Kriging, add them together. And you can just literally add them together, use a plus sign. Okay? And you'll get that. So, quick review, I think probably everybody here knows about regression trees and random forests, so I'll be quick here, but the decision tree is one tree and splits your data, recursive partitioning of your data, using the variables to identify one at a time, which variable is the best one to split that will result in the most homogeneous splits along the branches of your trees, and then you get the splitting again. So it's a continuous binary splitting until you get to predictions at the end. So this is an example of a classification tree. It's predicting zeros and ones, but of course you also do a regression tree where you can use the average of points in this location. Now, one of the things that people came to realize at some point was that individual trees didn't do so well. They sort of had a lot of limitations. They had high variance. And And so this led them to talk to some cattle ranchers because they had the answer. This I don't know if anybody saw this. This was kind of repeating something that was done at a World's Fair maybe in the 1900s or something like that. But on the internet, this group published this picture of Penelope the cow, and they asked the internet users to say how much Penelope weighed. And this is a histogram showing you everyone's guesses for Penelope. And remarkably, the average guess came out to be within 5% of her weight. And you're like, wait a second, somebody was guessing 50? Somebody was guessing zero? Okay, so these are internet trolls over here. I don't know, what were they thinking? Even with all of these bad guesses, the amazing thing is, in this ensemble of weak learners, most of these people knew nothing about cows. And yet, when you have people making mistakes on either side of the mean, you'll actually increase your signal. For those that do have information, you know, these mistakes on either side will cancel themselves out. You can actually get to an answer that way. Interestingly, the self-proclaimed cattle experts were off by another percentage point than the overall average. Okay, so random forest takes advantage of this by making many, many trees in a forest and making the trees decorrelate. So the trees are not similar to each other, and that way they might be like weak learners. So these decision trees are also made, or I'm sorry, this forest of trees is made using only a subset of the data, what they call bagging or bootstrap aggregation. So maybe only 60% of your data are used in each tree. That helps to decorrelate them. And then we make predictions by running the cases through all the trees and taking the majority vote or an average for classification or an average for regression. And neat thing about this, using only 60% of the data, is that you have out-of-bag samples that can be run through the tree. And those are essentially the same thing as a cross-validation. You can look at that as a cross-validation, or maybe even a conservative cross-validation. At least that's been my experience. Really no assumptions. You can use this with a lot of variables. It avoids overfitting. And in many cases, minimal tuning is required. There's default settings for how many variables to use. So the main hyperparameter is how many variables are investigated in each split on the tree. So to further decorrelate the trees, unlike the CART, the classification tree, where all variables are considered at each split, random forest only will examine a subset of variables in each split that are randomly collected. And this is the hyperparameter M-try, in R is what they call it. There are some limitations. You can't really extrapolate. Of course, you're not supposed to do that with regression, but either. And you may overestimate the lows and underestimate the highs. It can kind of pull in the ends. Some people also say there's bias in it. I played around with bias correction routines in random forest. I don't know. I didn't really have much success with that. Maybe someone else can help with that. Okay, so let's start over again with the training data of random forest. And so out of the box, no tuning, compared to the MLR on the training data, the out-of-bag R-squared was 7% lower than the multiple linear regression that was selected, and the root mean squared error was 0.02 higher. So not great. Percent variance explained, 18.3. So you can see that. So sometimes random forest doesn't do as well on some problems that are more linear. They are linear problems, so we did our subsets. But I said, let's go ahead and try tuning the hyperparameter M try. Maybe we can do better. So this particular random forest, it used the default of 3 variables to be considered in each split. Let's do tuning in caret on that. And so here's the code for that. And so we ended up selecting the n-try of 2, meaning only 2 variables should be. And here's a plot kind of showing you what happens to the root mean squared error as you increase the number of variables tried for each split. So it looks like n-try 2 is better. So let's go ahead and actually, this is interesting. I wanted to point this out. Okay, here our percent variance explained is 18.3, right? Not great. When we look at this cross, this tenfold, now it's actually tenfold repeated 3 times, it's repeated CV. So we look at this R squared for M-try 3 and it's 23.9. What's the difference there? Here's random forest, M-try 3, 500 trees, we get 18.3. Here is M-try 3, repeated cross-validation, we get 23.9. Anybody know why those aren't the same? they totally lost?
Well, I can hear the fly call, so.
You mean you're just sort of dipping your toe in data science?
Yes.
Well,
this way, it's looking at essentially more models, right?
Well, here's what I think. This was puzzling me this morning, and I realized these are not the same thing. So this percent variance explained is based on the out-of-bag errors. So this is actually the out-of-bag variance explained. I mean, random forest has the capability, you know, to fit every point exactly if you wanted to do that, but that isn't how the algorithm is set up. It's set up to avoid overfitting by paying attention to the out-of-bag errors. So these are the samples that were not run through a particular tree. That's what random forest is essentially optimizing, you know, on those, or using that as a test set. So this is what I meant by saying that really the out-of-bag tends to be conservative, because it's reporting only 18% variance explained, but here when we do repeated cross-validation for MTRI-3, we're getting 24%. That's better, and that's because, I believe it's because it's cross-validation and it's not out-of-bag. They're not actually the same thing. In some cases, they're going to be exactly, or not exactly the same. In some cases, they're going to be really close. Other cases, they're going to be a little bit different. And at least I have found on the problem sets that I've worked on, the out-of-bag tends to be conservative. So I don't know if anyone else has that experience. So for anybody who's really lost, I'll just say that the point of this exercise is that, you know, random forest is a really powerful data mining technique out of the box. Like, if you're like, I'm not sure what I want to learn, I know it's going to take me a few hours, a few days to learn a particular new algorithm, start with random forest. You know, just start right there. It's really good out of the box. It does really good. You don't even have to tune it. You just learn how to make it run, and you can make some good predictions. That's what I would say. But you can make it a little bit better. And you make it better by kind of tweaking a hyperparameter, which in this case is called mTRI. And so mTRI represents how many variables out of those 11 variables should this tree consider each time it makes a split. And it will randomly sample only 3 for each split. And it will say, oh, which one's the best out of these 3? Well, one of these other, out of the 11, could be much, much better to split the tree to make the nodes pure on the tree. But that particular tree in the forest doesn't get the opportunity to even look at those other variables. So the result is, it's a weak tree. It's not that great. And that's what we want. So we want each tree to not be very good. We want it to be different than all the other trees. Then, when we send the data through to make a prediction, by averaging all those weak learners, we'll get to the weight of the cow. Does that make sense, Tom?
Well, you need to add that you also select the number of the trees as the parameter.
Yes, but that's not supposed to affect the performance.
Oh, but it's an important, for exactly what you described, it's not supposed to affect the performance above certain thresholds. But obviously, if you select 2 random trees instead of, say, 700, it's going to, you'll get different results.
Right.
So if your random forest has, say, I mean, for most of the problems, there is a certain critical threshold, right?
Yes.
Like how many random trees you want.
Exactly.
So
nope, you're absolutely right. In fact, I was just going to get to that, and it's always like 2 slides ahead of me. But so what I was going to say is that, interestingly, when we look at, here it is, although 1 slide ahead of me, okay, I'm catching up. So although there's a debate about whether entry affects performance beyond a certain size, so for example, you know, the random forest algorithm uses 500 as a default. So if you don't specify an R and you just run random forest, it uses 500 of these decorrelated trees. Well, it turns out if you boost the number of trees more, it takes longer, but it usually adds a little bit of performance. So I like to play around with the 500, and then eventually when I'm down to what I think is the final model, I bump it up to 10,000. So anyway, so here, when we do this, when we go with our optimized parameter of 2 and using 10,000 trees, the out-of-bag R-squared bumps up about 3% and the root mean squared error goes down a little bit. So there is an improvement in doing this. So now we're at 20% variance explained. And this is still using just the training data though. So let's go ahead and bring in the full data set. or and actually we need to evaluate it on the test data, sorry. Okay, so the random forest on the test data, now we're starting to see something that doesn't look like it quite matches here in terms of the match. So the R-squared came out really good on the test data, 58%. But again, the root mean squared error kind of went in the wrong direction, and it doesn't really look like it follows the one-to-one line very well. But then again, so there's a tendency for the model to be under-predicting at high values. And my question on this is this chance, is this bias due to using this particular algorithm, or is this a chance result? Now, I don't know for sure, but let's see how it looks on the full data set. So refit the random forest to all data, and of course I use the hyperparameter that was found before to work well too, and the 10,000 that I like. And so now we come up with the performance on the full data set as the out of bag R squared is 33%. So definitely better using more data, and we have 0.42 for the root mean squared error. And you can see that this looks much better when you use all the data, on the observed versus predicted plot. Still a little twist there though, right? There's still something going on. And I think that gets at the idea of the bias that's inherent in random forest. Something that I think would be interesting to do more work on. There are bias correction methods. I tried to get them to work. Just not sure it ever really did much. So, okay, now one of the accusations that people make about fancier machine learning techniques is that you don't know what's going on, right? It's a black box. So this is another Danny Gooding picture where they're doing something called light painting, and they shine their lights at night and take a picture so that you can actually see what's happening in the forest. I thought this was appropriate because you can look inside the random forest. You can do, as long as you set importance equal true when you're running your algorithm, you get these two plots very easily with var importance plot. Of course, you got two, so you don't know which one do I use, right? And but nicely, they came out with similar things, that Zurich ratio and drawdown were both important, the two most important variables. So this one, percent mean squared error, this is based on permutations of the data. So one at a time, these different variables are substituted with randomized data to see what performance there is on the tree. If the performance degrades significantly, hey, that must have been an important variable. So this, some people believe this is sort of give you a more general idea of the importance of the variable, and then this one is based on how many times was that variable used in splitting the tree, and how well did it improve the tree's performance. So some people say this is a little bit more associated with tree-specific aspects of the importance of the variable. And then recently I saw somewhere someone said this is like junk, so I need to read more about it.
It's not junk if you use one tree, but if you use random trees, people don't. Like if you use one decision tree, they have perfect explanations.
Right?
Because
okay.
One decision tree just tells you, yeah, I split this variable at this point, with this value, and so obviously explanation is there. And because this driving selection can actually tell you quite a lot. But how people extrapolate this to random forests? And to some extent, that's the whole point. You don't want these explanations to happen. You want much more. You're sacrificing explanations for predictability.
For prediction. Yeah.
The one on the left, this is my favorite. This is like Kevin's last presentation.
You used this one?
No, he was showing some other stuff, but most of the things I was hacking about, it's like using the one on the left. It's my favorite. Like I do randomly, scramble some part of the data or damage the data in some way,
okay,
in order to kind of see. In some sense, that's the most algorithm agnostic procedure, which can be applied to any method. And so you can have correlations between variables. So yes, you need to actually select, multiple variables, just kind of, if you, but in general, the one on the left is supposed to tell you more. I mean, anyone can reproduce it, at least in principle. It is very time consuming though.
Okay, and this could be, and you're kind of sharing with the group that this could be done really in any algorithm. You could always scramble,
yes,
your data and run it again,
right,
and see what happens. So.
Yeah, it can be time consuming. This is the drawback, but so that's why people use the one,
right?
But it's a heuristic.
Yeah. So and so on a practical note, the one on the right is the one that random forest gives you automatically. So if you set importance equal true, then you can also get the one on the left. So keep that in mind. Okay, and here's another. another view into the tree, which is a partial dependence plot. And this gives us some idea that as xeric ratio increases, the soils are more sandy soils around the wetland, we tend to have lower water levels. So you can see it's kind of a nice boop-boop-boop, almost like a linear relationship there. So maybe this is why linear regression works pretty well for this problem. Now this one looks a little bit less linear, but again, as the drawdown increases, we have lower water levels. And maybe there's a little bit of a plateau here. And then here's the third and last variable I'm going to show you the partial dependence plot for. This is rainfall. So rainfall doesn't seem to have much relationship with water levels until you get to some sites that had very high rainfall, and then you see the water levels are much higher there. At least this is what the random forest thinks. Okay, so what about the residuals from random forest? Just like the regression, we can look at the residuals and say, do they show any positive spatial autocorrelation? If they do, that opens the door to creeping those residuals and improving our prediction a little bit. And so they do show positive spatial autocorrelation. It's interesting, as I mentioned, I've worked on a more recent project where I used 29 variables, and the variogram looked like this. So it was actually negative spatial autocorrelation at the close lags. So you can't do creeping in that case. No one's invented that creeping system. I think that would be good to do. Someone could invent that. But at this point, that's not available. There's only certain equations that can be used to fit the variogram. And if you don't meet those equations, you can't use creeping. Okay, here's the unfortunate part. I will say this, there's a package called GSIF, which offers the possibility of inserting random forest instead of a linear model into the regression Kriging equation. But I wasn't that familiar with how to get that to run. And also, I would still have to do a loop to cross-validate that because it didn't offer a cross-validation the way AutoMap does. So I went ahead and I wrote this, which holds out one point at a time from both the random forest and the Kriging to represent that as an out of sample. So what comes out of this loop is actually out of sample. The point was held out from both the random forest and the Kriging. And so here's what we get. With the Kriging, the random forest is still 4% R squared behind the regression Kriging. And the RMSE is a little bit worse. And so there's the observed versus expected plot. Okay, so here's the summary of models. This table here summarizes all the models that we walked through. We did linear regression first. Then I said, this is our BIC best linear regression. I said, let's go ahead and allow an interaction. So professional judgment to allow an interaction. Looked at the cross-validation, yeah, it was a little bit better. And so our R-squared was improved there a little bit. And then we said, okay, let's take a step back and ignore these auxiliary variables. Just look at ordinary Kriging. Wow, that's pretty good. That's actually better than the linear regression. But let's combine the two. And that's really our best one, where the R-squared is about 40.6 and the RMSE is 0.4. Also looked at random forest as an alternative. Not as good. And then the random forest Kriging was actually the second best. So taking the random forest and combining that with the Kriging. So my kind of take-home message here is that, you know, some problems are inherently linear, and so adding extra uninformative variables in that case, or non-linear potential for detecting non-linearities is not going to help you. More complex models not going to help you in that case. The residuals actually look pretty similar among the top three models. This is the ordinary Kriging, the random forest Kriging, and the regression Kriging. So they're similar, but you can see the range is a little tighter for the one that came out ranked better. And then here they are back transformed. So one of the interesting things, and you know, when you transform your dependent variable and you back transform, you will end up with asymmetric, right? Confidence intervals or prediction intervals. But you can see they're very similar, but again, you have a little bit of a tighter range. And so, but zooming in on this gives the client a better idea of, well, what can I expect for these unmonitored sites that you're going to predict water levels for? And so what I found is that about 62% of the regression Kriging residuals were within plus or minus a foot. So we're predicting median water levels for 62% of them within plus or minus a foot. So not perfect, but it's something that can be used for planning purposes. You know, maybe we can screen out some areas and we don't have to look at in the field because we're pretty sure they're recovered. Or other areas where we're pretty sure there's going to be a problem there. And so this is what it looks like when you apply, when you give a grid to the auto map, you can then actually get a nice kriging for your whole study area. And this is some sort of artifact here happening on the edges. And then again, I'm not just going to show you the standard error map, which also would get a standard error map as well. And then I went ahead and just color-coded it to show which areas would represent places where the wetlands are going to be recovered. So if your blue would be within minus 1.8 feet of the normal pool, so all of these areas should have wetlands that are in good condition hydrologically. The yellow area are the areas that are between the minus 1.8 and minus 3.1. So those are areas where the isolated cypress domes in the mesic settings may still have a problem hydrologically. But we think that the more xeric sites, the sandhill sites with a greater fluctuation of water level, would be healthy in those areas, and or recovering if they had lower water levels. And then the orange represents areas that are still likely an issue. So based on this threshold. And so based on that, we can spatially assign the results to the sites, keeping in mind, first we calculated, you know, was the site xeric or mesic, and then applied the thresholds. And so you can see in here that we have some, about 37% would be considered recovered, or shown here in blue. And some of the areas that are on certain well fields still seem to have issues. So we have to look at those further. Comments or questions? Yes?
Is part of the issue here in Pinellas, they have saltwater intrusion, and you're trying to prevent that, or is it to preserve the ecosystem of the cypress tree?
No, saltwater intrusion, that actually happened a long time ago. So, initially when people first moved to that part of Florida, they were able to take freshwater out of the ground. There's like a freshwater lens, so that can get used up. And so that's done. So you can't take freshwater out of the ground there. No, you can take brackish water out, and so then you can treat it with reverse osmosis, and that's something that they're doing.
But is it a concern that would also happen in Hillsborough, or is the geology different?
Well, that is a concern, and so as part of the water use permit, which regulates the utility, they monitor that to make sure that that's not happening. And they also do modeling to predict what's happening with the saline wedge. So that could be a concern. I do not believe in this case, you know, that was really the driver behind the urge to get off of the groundwater, to make that just part of the portfolio of water, because, you know, essentially we're seeing these environmental impacts, and I think that was the main driver, you know, from my perspective. Saline intrusion was not that much of an issue, or, you know, it had already happened in certain areas. But it's definitely something that's monitored as part of the problem. Yes?
I have 8 comments.
8?
And
you're not writing them? You didn't write them down?
Yeah.
You're like one of those killer waiters that are like, yeah, just everything's perfect.
So it's impressive work. Lots of ground, and actually I have to say, most of the people I talk to who apply data science, it's mostly about social media and human behavior, which in some sense it's easier. I mean, in many ways it's easy, and it's also who cares. But this, you know, much more important and interesting. So my biggest comment, I would say, from all of these 8, you know, like the most important one is that when you have so much kind of questions about your modeling, it's in some sense, in general, it's better to change the paradigm of the solution. And so in general, data science statistics, this is like the third best approach. The best one is to do scientific simulations, or, you know, much more scientific computations. So this is actually my question here. To some extent, it seems that from the first slide, you have enough physics and structural information about the problem, but you might be better off doing model with partial differential equations, with whatever, right? And then calibrate it with the existing data, instead of trying to use the existing data to make statistical models. You see what I'm saying? It's like, for example, when I say I'm simulating virus propagation, you know, like in some country,
I can figure out like how the viruses propagate by contact with people and etc. I can make a relatively simple model of 5-6 equations, probably propagated for different ages and etc. The data I would get from these countries, like say Thailand, whatever, it's usually very small. I cannot make a statistical model, but I can use this data to calibrate this, you know, partial differential equations model. So I'm saying something like that probably here is applicable to a point. Is it possible to simulate the physical or represent the physical process with certain physics equations, build a model in that sense, scientific, you know, computations model, and then calibrate it with the existing data?
Now, here's the problem. You're looking at the guy, okay? There's not a lot of people who are in this area, you know? You have people, you have a lot of resources that have been invested in modeling. So they're modeling, what are the effects of rainfall, groundwater pumping, evaporation, very, very complex models, millions of dollars spent, many, many years, calibration, you know? And so that gives us a good idea. Still, there's big error bars there, right, in some cases?
Of course, yeah.
But it gives us some idea of where are the water levels in the various, you know, aquifers. And really, the superficial aquifer is very difficult to predict. Florida aquifer is easier in most cases. But the point is that we have some idea of what's happening in the aquifers. Only thing we know about what's happening in the wetlands is if someone's going out there and measuring it. So, you know, we have...
There's no much science more behind.
Okay. What's that?
There's no much more science than that, than measuring.
Well, you're looking at it, you know? So that's why I'm saying that I'm looking at this multivariate approach as not just trying to predict, but also trying to understand. So that's my point of saying when we look at how the data, we can get back there.
Yeah,
when we look at what might be happening in terms of, let's go back to an exploratory plot. Something like this. So really through this process we're seeing, hey, you know, maybe the same amount of drawdown is different in areas where you have very xeric soils. Maybe there's a different statistical relationship here. And so then we can use that to make predictions for those types of wetlands. Right? If you ignore that, you go back to your ordinary kriging solution, you just say we're just gonna creep the water levels as they are. So we're trying to develop that science really. So I don't think we're to the differential equation point. Now, one thing that some people have done is looked at transfer function noise models, you know, on a wetland by wetland basis, or actually doing water budget modeling on a wetland by wetland basis. And so in that case, you can make some predictions. And I've done some of that work using a rainfall decay model, so you can spend a lot of time and energy on a particular site to try to understand what's happening with that site. But that will only give you so much information about what's happening at nearby sites. And I think that's where the statistical approach comes in to make the predictions.
This would be my second question. Is it possible with the data accumulated to find similar sites or sites with similar structure, like not Florida, in some other continent? Is it possible at all? You see what I'm saying? Like say, just in some sense, the diversification of models you did would be very nice if you do diversification of the locations, right? Mm-hmm. Or there's, you know, so you either, right now, it's not clear to me what is the time span you're looking at, but it would be very nice if you actually can either use all the data or use, you know, different locations,
yep.
Let's say different continents.
I do have other clients and have looked at similar relationships and found similar relationships in other parts of Florida, like Manatee County and Polk County. And so, yes, I mean, we do see similar things happening. Now, there are areas where the hydrogeology is different. Like when you go, maybe south of I-4, you get into areas where there's a lot more confinement. So the wetlands there, they may be insulated from pumping in the Florida aquifer. So then you're mostly affecting things like spring flow at that point. You're not necessarily affecting the wetlands. But again, the geology is variable. So yeah, I think that's always good to look at cases in other areas, and I have been trying to do that.
Yeah. This is the thing. I mean, if you, I did large-scale air pollution simulations. When you say very few people people when we're doing large-scale, 20 years ago, large-scale evolution simulations of continents. Nobody, like, there are like five people in the whole world doing it. But how do you compare results? How do you validate methods? You know, so this was the question. And so this, to some extent, it can be an insurmountable problem if you don't, if there's not enough people and enough data looking into this, you know, then in a sense, you need to choose the methods which are easy to achieve, like say carrot in R, you know, whatever. It's like easy to apply, easy to get into.
Yeah, or maybe, you know, maybe we can talk about it further though. That'd be good. Thank you.
Right, yeah, sure.
That's three questions. You got more?
Oh, no, I do have more. I just don't want to monopolize them.
Anybody else? Yes.
I was just in the context of what you learned looking at the data as well as the predictive analytics portion, are there any variables or data that you identified that you don't have that you would like to have in the future?
Hmm. Yeah, that's a good question. Well, one of the variables I didn't include here was Florida aquifer drawdown. So just looking at the superficial model predictions, but there's also predictions for what's happening in the Florida. And one of the things that's come out of the Central Florida Water Initiative area, which I'm more involved with now here in Orange County, is the recognition that maybe these more xeric sites, they have a different name for them here, they call them ridge sites, but it's a similar concept, similar paradigm that's developing. And one of the things they're looking at is they believe those fluctuate more with the Florida than they do with the superficial. So I think it would be good to redo this and include the Florida data in there. That would be one thing. But in a recent project, I looked at two different time periods, pre-cutback and post-cutback. And that was one of the things that I was pushing for, was to get the data for the pre-cutback drawdown to be able to include that, and was able to include that in this later work that was done. But I wanted to present this today because I felt this was maybe more applicable to a larger audience with the idea of the regression kriging and kind of introducing the geostatistics to those that haven't had any exposure to that. Question? Yes?
Two questions. One has to do with outliers, because it looks like there are some extreme points out there. Did you have to do some investigation to just see whether those were valid data or not?
I would say, in terms of, you know, in terms of outliers, pretty much tried to include everything, and that's really, you know, the random forest. The random forest deals great with outliers. I actually did, they're non-existent terrain for us, right? Because I remember I accidentally included some -999s I had put in as placeholders for missing values. Random Forest came out with a beautiful R-squared, great predictive ability, and then I realized the data still had the -99, so something to keep in mind. But you know, one -999 will ruin your regression, right? So it does matter what algorithm you're using when you worry about outliers. So I would say, certainly we mapped the data and looked at the data. There was definitely some screening process that went into it as far as, you know, which wetlands provide sufficient data to calculate median water levels, because some sites might have had a gap in the time period, or, you know, I wanted the data from 2008 to 2014 or whatever I used in the study, but maybe I only had four of those years. Well, is that sufficient to calculate a median? I mean, technically, you know, maybe. I mean, if the rainfall was similar in the previous 2 years, you could maybe keep it in. So definitely there was a lot of screening to decide which sites would go in there, and to make sure that they were reasonable. But I tried to use all of the data, excluded some sites that were augmented. If you look at those are actually having sites that have water added to them to maintain some kind of water level, because they were so dry historically that they needed to maintain a pool of water there for wildlife. So those get excluded, stuff like that.
And did you have data on the amount of water being pumped since you were working for the water company?
As far as?
How much water, million gallons per day, were being pumped by the various well fields and how that changed over time?
I didn't have to do that because I was really focused on, you know, making estimations for a representative time period. So choosing this particular time period that I chose, the 2008 to 2014, 2014, I think. This time period was after the cutbacks, so it was going to be at 90 million gallons per day, and they run certain scenarios to say this is a typical distribution of pumpage. You know, it's going to change, you know, annually and from time to time. Tampa Bay Water actually has an interactive program. They call the OROP, the Optimized Regional Operations Plan. So they're monitoring certain wells to see, is the water being drawn down too much in this location? And if it is, they shift pumpage away from that. So that's part of their system. So yes, it will change away from this. So that sort of goes into that whole assumptions box and category to say, I'm comparing water levels in these wetlands, but in actuality, the pumpage distribution might have been a little bit different. So that's part of why you see so much scatter, you know, that's one part of it. So.
No, my background was in forecasting the annual water consumption, so I know the impact of rainfall. It's not linear.
Okay. Awesome.
Because in Central Florida, a lot of the water is being used for irrigation.
50%.
Yeah.
It's incredible.
So that caused that. Then when the rainfall changes, then you get a non-linear response on the consumption.
This actually
changes the amount being pumped.
Interesting point. Like if the non-linearity is baked in into the program, you should try to not use regression, meaning try to categorize the variables. This is actually one of the things I'll try with Randall Forest. Can you predict high and low or whatever,
mm-hmm.
right? And then the prediction rate, you can base it, because it becomes a classification algorithm at this point, right? Not regression. These techniques for finding the decisive variables, right? Like, you know, scrambling the data and the test data, etc. They can give you quite interesting information exactly from this perspective. You might have much better predictive ability if you try to make discrete labels, like as I said, high and low. Especially some of the regressions fits I saw, usually when I see it, yeah, I mean, it's basically more or less a ball of points or disk of points with some line. Fine, we can calculate root mean square, but actually, it's not that representative apparently. But using, if the non-linearity is there, then it's better to address the non-linearity by using labels. And this usually works, like I recently had to do some kind of energy efficiency model for some hospital in England. And one of the things is that if you do regression, you know, like, yeah, you get something like this is completely not operational. But if I use this discretization, actually the decisive variables in the system, right, which is like say temperature, occupancy, and some other stuff, right, and they immediately kind of show. And again, no, you cannot exactly the situation is not simple. They're like multiple mm-hmm. things coming in, but the most decisive variable, just to understand what are the big players, right? This was very, very useful.
Well, let me say this and just make sure I understand it. The main reason for using the predicting the median water level relative to a local elevation datum in the wetland was because we have an understanding of wetland health and how it relates to that median water level. We don't necessarily have an understanding of the high and the low. And in fact, even a very stressed wetland can actually fill up with water. After a hurricane, it can be full of water. So you could have a stressed wetland that has fallen trees and everything else that one day when you visit it, you're like, oh, it's full of water, everything's fine. Like, but a biologist would be like, no, actually, you've got, this plant doesn't belong there. You've got a 3-inch DBH tree that's, you know, that's an upland tree growing in the center of the wetland. So you have to understand, you know what I'm saying? So max and min
no,
might not
be. No, it doesn't need to be high or low. I mean, close to the medium, healthy, not healthy. Imagine
mm-hmm.
you do this, right? I mean, you obviously, if you're looking for the medium,
mm-hmm.
you should have some idea about that. Or you can just determine what is the cutoff threshold. Apparently, some of the models you saw with the, you showed with the random forest, they're very non-linear kind of thresholds, right? About the rainfall, for example,
mm-hmm.
etc. It's exactly this. Imagine with some threshold of labeling, making, discretizing the problem, you actually get much better results.
Oh, so, I see what you're saying. Okay,
yeah,
so you're saying
right.
instead of making it a continuous problem, make it a yes-no.
Yes. Right.
Okay.
Right. Oh, yeah, yes-no.
All right,
maybe.
I played around with that a little bit. It didn't seem much better, but yeah, I can try that again. And then also, the other thing is I will tell you, I did do that classification approach for wetland health. So I'm talking here about wetland hydrology, which translates to wetland health. But there's also There's also actually data that's been collected at over 800 sites in the Tampa Bay area where biologists have visited the sites and rated the site using a multimetric scale of saying, okay, this has weedy species, this has upland species, this has soil subsidence, fallen trees, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, coming up with a score on a scale of 1 to 5, or in earlier years it was 1 to 3. And I can turn that into a yes, no, stressed or not. So I did that using random forest and 29 variables, and I was getting around 80% or better prediction. So, I mean, you know, that may support what you're saying, that it's easier to classify yes, no.
So if you have done this in 80%, you already can run the decisiveness of the variables on that. Mm-hmm. And also you can use the residual operating characteristics to see further, can you actually squeeze out something of the model?
Yeah.
And in some sense, that's more, because it's discrete, right? We don't, it's a little bit easier to stage the experiments and see the interesting variables in play. But, you know, again, you know.
Well, so one thing that would be nice, though, that now we might have conflicting answers, right? Because this model can give us a prediction for the water levels, and this other model with an 80% R-squared, this model has a 40% R-squared.
I don't believe in regression that much in general.
Okay.
All right.
So let's pretend I didn't
so
do regression,
right.
But let's pretend I've got a water level model that has a 40% R-squared, and I have a ecological model that has an 80% R-squared. You know, how do you combine that information? I mean, do you use Bayesian statistics, or what? You know, what do you do at that point?
You're predicting discrete levels, and the discrete levels, there should be some quantitative range behind the discrete levels, right?
Mm-hmm.
Or at least this is how I understand it. This is what I was suggesting. So. I'll just use that. Like say, okay, let me simplify. Imagine I'm trying.
But I'm saying, what if you get different answers? So what if the water levels say, well, no, you're not actually recovered. The prediction says you are recovered.
Okay, so this was.
No one's been to the site. The aerial photos are uninformative. Someone's gonna have to be paid to go
it's
there.
It's one of my 8 comments. So this was too much statistical. The first 1/3 of the slides is statistical. You know, statistical exposition. Which is fine.
No, say it again, I want
to
hear.
It's a statistical exposition to 1/3 of the presentation was more about statistics.
Yeah.
And in machine learning, we just have multiplicity of models. I mean, this is something you mentioned too. There is no one model which explains it all. Actually, we try to live with the fact that you have multiple models which give good results, good predictability results.
Mm-hmm.
So we do embrace multidimensionality. We don't care about, vectors being independent. Actually, quite on the contrary, we want them to be dependent as much as possible, because like algorithms like random forest, etc., we can deal with this. This is very different from what statisticians trying to do. They usually try to eliminate the variables, they try to eliminate collinearities and so forth, right? So I'm not talking about understanding, actually, in a sense here. For me, two models giving, you know, if they predict equally well and they have results which contradict, we just need to make another model and probably produce another solution which is good. And and this is why I'm saying that having too many models thrown at the problem, it's exactly the same type of overfitting you discussed earlier with one model. It's kind of the same thing. At some point, if you're using too many models, of course, one of them is going to be better than the others. But then the question is, how is this better model, you know, selected? Is it really better on absolute grounds? So that's why I was saying, can you apply this to a different situation, to a different spatial environment or whatever, to see what this model actually holds? Also, it's the best one there. So for me, there's two models giving different results and equal predictive power, but with different variables, that's just fine. I mean, again, especially when you look at predicting human behavior, usually, like say, take something like the FICO or FICO score, FICU, and the, you know, the credit card score, they actually can't explain the ones they predict with. What they found is that they do actually have multiple, you know, multiple models produce relatively good results. At some point, they did settle down for neural networks just because it's fancier than, say, you know, random forests or whatever. But, you know, in general, you know, it's like, they live with the fact that they cannot explain it. They just have a model, you know, which does that. Now, in some situations, you know, as I said, especially from a machine learning perspective, that's just fine. I actually do expect different, if you train, say, random forest, or you train on neural networks or on Bayesian classifiers, of course, you pick different variables. This doesn't mean that they're wrong. You know, it's like, how do I reconcile them? You either make an ensemble, you know, which is, you know, basically the collaging of different models, or if you try to do explainability, then, well, actually, I'll be doing this algorithm agnostic procedure we're discussing, you know, which usually should unearth some of the correlations.
Okay. Yeah, and in a way, I mean, this regression kriging is an ensemble, right? Because you're doing a model, then you have residual variation, and then you're explaining the residual variation. So in that way, it's kind of like a boosted tree, you know. In a way, you're fitting what's left over with a different model, but you're not actually having an explanatory variable other than covariation in space. So you're fitting the structure of the noise is what you're doing. So you're recognizing, you're acknowledging a structure in the noise, and you're correcting the model for that structure.
Right. This is more or less a universal pattern. And that's why when I was talking earlier about scientific computation approach to this, some of the so-called multi-grid methods, they're doing exactly this, but they're using differential equations. I'll shut up.
I'm interested in learning more about the differential equation part of it to see if that's something that we can use.
I would invite to follow the discussion of the Irish pub now.
Thank you.
Wonderful presentation. Please join us.
Feel free to, you know, email me or, you know, if you have any questions. I also have some business cards up here, and are you going to post that link on the,
yes,
on the website for the GitHub?
We're going to have a reference to Dan's
They're going to
GitHub.
Load it in the GitHub.
Yeah.
Excuse me.
They're going to load the presentation. The
yeah.
GitHub.
So this is the GitHub. Yeah. And so the presentation is on there also as a PDF file.
Great.
So yeah, you can definitely you know, but let me know, and if I'm open to collaborations too, so.